So we'll just wait for 3-4 more minutes and then we'll start off.
Okay,
Let me
sure.
Just let everyone to join. All the participants who have any queries to ask them, sir, at the end, you could just, you know, raise your hands and we'll unmute you from our side. And then you can go ahead and ask your queries. We're just waiting for 2-3 minutes so that when everyone joins, we'll start off by 4-5 around.
Okay, sure.
Okay, so I guess we are good to go. We'll start off. Welcome, sir. It's been like the pandemic has been very long. It's been almost 6 months and all the students have, you know, found this amazing way to gain more knowledge by doing webinars and seminars and connecting with those who, you know, inspire us, those who can teach us a lot of stuff. So we are all at our homes, which is not necessarily near the college. We are like far away. Some people are in the, you know, far corners of the country. But yeah, by this way, we have found it, you know, easier to connect with you people who are ready to, you know, guide us in this journey. And we'd like to thank you for that. And to begin with, for all the participants, I'll just introduce our speaker for today, Mr. Kaustubh Pawar. So Mr. Kaustubh Pawar is an M.Pharm graduate from ICT Mumbai. He has been an academic topper at Maharashtra Institute of Pharmacy, Pune, and has secured an All India rank of 2. Okay, that's a single digit rank. So an All India rank of 2 in the GPAT examinations in 2018. He had ranked amongst the top 5 throughout his B.Pharm at Savitribai Phule Pune University. He was honored as the best outgoing student by Maharashtra Institute of Pharmacy Pune in the academic year 2017-2018. He delivers preparatory guest lectures on preparation strategies for GPAT at various reputed institutes and online platforms. As you see, you know, in his background, Pharmascopy. So Pharmascopy by Kaustubh Pawar was his own initiative, which was an online educational platform for pharmacy, GPAT, NIPA, and other entrance examinations and competitive examinations, which he started on Instagram and YouTube. He's one of us. He's one of the, you know, new generation pharma people, and we are so glad to have you over here to guide us. So welcome, and the stage is yours.
Yeah, first of all, thank you. It was a lovely introduction, and I'm amongst yourself only. I was an alumni of IPSF, I can say, and I worked with IPSF, so it's a wonderful platform. It's a leadership building platform, we can say, which was initiated by Neeraj Bapna, who is an alumni of Bharatiya Vidyapeeth, so PharmD division. So it's a great platform. I've learned a lot of things while working with IPSF. So that tenure was the, like, I can say, one of the greatest period of my BPharm graduate. And I'm thankful for IPSF for inviting me to deliver and to share my insights and knowledge and my experience, which I can say, which I gained throughout my BPharm journey, and how and why and what I did to get that All India rank 2. So let's start. So I've just prepared one presentation, so it is easy and it's not that much boring to hear me. So we will start with it. So my slide is visible.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, cool. So we will start. So first of all, so today, as our topic or as our theme is on journey of becoming an All India ranker. So I did my graduation as from MIT and my master's from MPharm, and I'm working with Lupin right now. So first, again, thankful for IPSF for inviting me. So So let's start with my beginning of my journey, how my journey started from BPharm, as well as how I started my journey for GPAT preparation also. Because this, the beginning decides your aim or the goal. So that's why for every movie or for every journey or for every process, beginning is much more important than the end. So my journey for BPharm started, or we can say for GPAT started, when I joined the BPharm by chance. So it's like saying for a BPharm graduate or BPharm joining, that whether you have joined the BPharm by chance or by choice. So that question everybody asks. So my journey for a BPharm also started by a chance. So when I joined my BPharm, at that time, I decided that whatever in future I will do, that I will do by my choice. It won't be by chance. So that was the decision which I made on the first day of my BPharm, I can say. Because whenever you do anything by choice and whenever you do what you like, you excel in it. It's a, we can say, globally accepted phenomenon. And that's why I've decided ki whatever I will do, that I will do it by choice, by whatever I like to do. And that day, there was a feeling of doing something great. And that feeling was a propellant throughout my journey of BPharm, as well as throughout my journey of becoming All India ranker. So as you can see, I have just put a photo of Goblet of Fire from Harry Potter series. So as you can say, that feeling of doing something great was my Goblet of Fire, and of that I joined the BPharm by chance and not by choice. So that two factors decided and propelled me throughout my journey. So you, anyone who has done a great things, or I have done not, I'm a beginner in my field, I can say. So anybody who does a great thing in his life, he requires something that motivates. So he should have that fire in his belly. So I can say that these things has motivated me throughout my journey. Day and night has kept me awake to do and to achieve the goal which I had decided for my BPharm graduation. So then moving ahead. So after deciding, after knowing that, yes, I want to do something great, I had to decide what should be my purpose for starting this journey of GPAT. Because in third year, like in first 2 years, the graduation, they go likewise, like you get adjusted and then you get to know few things and life goes on. But in third year, that is the point where you have to choose ki, okay, after fourth year, what you want to do. And in third year, I decided ki, okay, I want to pursue my master's. And for that, there is an entrance exam called as GPAT. So that, at that time, when I decided to enroll or to start my preparation for GPAT, I had to decide ki, what will be my purpose for starting this journey. Because it's a journey, it's a long process. You cannot become an All India ranker within a night. So for that, I decided that my purpose will be to be excellent. So I focused, I started focusing on gaining knowledge and mastering the skills. So these two are the key important factors, parameters that actually decides whether you will get your All India rank or you will qualify or you will excel in your dreams or goals. Because just focusing on the end product, it's difficult. But if you focus on the process, it's pretty easy to achieve the end product. And the dialogue or the philosophy, I can say, which has been like one of the pillar of my journey is from the three idiots. Ki success ke piche mat bhago, excellence ka picha karo, success jak maar ke tumhare piche aayega. And it's true. So when you will be excellent in your job or in your work or whatever you might be do, it's guaranteed, it's sure that you are going to achieve your goal. So always remember, whatever your goal might be, you should be excellent in whatever you do. After deciding my purpose, so that was my propellant and that was my journey. Yeah, I wanted to be excellent throughout my graduation and throughout the journey of GPAT, whatever I might learn. Then you have to decide your target. So my target for what? Like GPAT is an end product. So for a GPAT, what target you have to achieve? Do you have to only get qualified or do you want to get an All India rank? So that is the target which is essential so that you will be focused, determined throughout your journey. So while deciding my target in third year, my goal, I decided that I want to score above 300. Now you might, many of you might have heard this. So just for revision. So when I did a survey till 2017 of the All India rankers. So average score of All India ranker till 2017 was around 260 marks out of 500. So we have 500 ka GPAT. So if you get around 260, you were All India ranker till 2017. So at that point, I decided that I want to score above 300 my goal was not to get an All India ranker, but to score above 300. And why it is so? Because if I do so, if I'm able to get that score above 300 mark, eventually I will be among top three. Wo to hona hi tha, because the history says that till 270, 260, the candidate is All India ranker. So that is the philosophy number two of mine. Aim for the gold, then you will land up with the silver. And to get gold, aim for the world record. So whenever there is a person or an Olympian, he or she always try to get a world record, to set a world record, to set a bar. So that was my goal. So my goal was to get score above 300, all-time high. And by the God's grace, I was able to do so. I was able to get 318. Which till today stands the second highest score in GPAT history. So that was my target. So this is that, why do you want to do it? So in every journey, there are three things which I will tell you. First thing is why you want to do it. And it is the most important and the core of any journey, because that is the thing which will propel you through the journey. So always decide, why do you want to do the thing which you are meant to do? Then after deciding my why, after deciding my purpose, after deciding my target, we have a syllabus. So I had to see ki how to prepare and how to prepare my syllabus. So when you open your GPAT syllabus, we have around 20 subjects. And it's tough that to acquire each and every knowledge from each and every subject. It's tough. Like, it's possible, but it's tough. So how you can achieve one by one? So you should aim that, rather than being jack of all, that you will prepare moderately for each and every subject, rather than doing so, be master of most. Start with one subject, one topic, one concept, be master of that, study thoroughly and acquire each and every bit of knowledge from that topic, from that concept, and then move to the next subject, next topic. So likewise, when you will start from the day one and at the end of the your journey, you will be master of most of the topics, most of the subjects in throughout the GPAT syllabus. So this is the way you should decide, or you should start your journey. You should decide how you are going to study, how which subjects you are going to study first, and likewise you are going to master one by one. So this was the about the syllabus. Now moving to how I started my preparation and how you all can start your preparation for GPAT. So likewise, in GPAT syllabus or in GPAT, we have three categories of subjects, we can say. First are the minor subjects, which are the basic subjects which we study in first year and second year of our BPharm graduation. And then there are major subjects, which are the core of any BPharm pharmacy, that is pharmaceutics, biotechnology, biopharmacology, medicinal chemistry, likewise. So these are the major subjects from which maximum questions appear in any competitive exam, let's say GPAT, NIPER, or any other competitive exam. And there are allied subjects like jurisprudence, management, which are equally important as that of major subjects. So whenever you will start your journey, whenever you start your preparation, I will always prefer that you should start with the basics. Start with the first year, second year syllabus like physical pharmacy, physical chemistry, organic chemistry, microbiology, HAP pathology. Because when you will get the concepts clear of the basic topics, it will be very easy for you to learn the major concept, major topics, and the core concepts of the pharmacy, which is pharmaceutics. Because its foundation has to be strong. And that's why start with the basics, make your basics strong, clear, and the concept should be thoroughly revised. Then only it will be easy and you will be able to correlate and understand the major concepts like pharmaceutics, tablets, likewise. And then move to allied subjects. So this is the flow, how you should start your preparation, how you should assign your time. And likewise, you will be able to complete each and every topic or each and every subject at the end of your preparation. Now the most important point from a GPAT aspirant is that how to manage your time. And it's not that much tough, but whenever I deliver sessions, each and every student has this question, how to manage our time. So I will always prefer if I think so there are many students from third year, second year, and final year also. So my suggestion will be you should start your preparation from third year, because in third year you have knowledge of first year, second year, you know what are the basic concepts, and then you will get around 1 year of time period for your preparation if you start in third year, 1 and 1.5 years. And it's more than sufficient and it's ideal span that a student can get to prepare for its GPAT. So how you can allot your time, or how can I allot your months to the subject? So how I did? So I just when I started with the minor subjects, I decided that in 5 months of my 12 months or 16 months time period, I will complete all the minor subjects in the first 5 months. And then after that, after knowing the minor subjects, I will move to the major subjects, and around 5 to 6 months will be the time which I will give for the major subjects. And when it will be a month of November and December, because in January or February we have the exam, I will revise those topics. So this was the plan which I decided, and I went systematically through this plan. Now you know within how many months you have to prepare a subject. But within how many weeks do we have to allot, or do we have to give for a minor subject? That is much more important. So for any GPAT preparation, for any competitive exam, if there are students who are appearing for MBA, who want to give CAT, or who will be appearing for NIPER exam, it's essential that you study daily, because daily preparation is the key and is the main part which guarantees you that you will get your all-India rank or you will qualify. So I won't say that study for 6 and 7 hours, but at least study 2 to 3 hours. Invest your 2 to 3 hours of your daily schedule for the GPAT preparation. And likewise, if you study daily 2 to 3 hours, it's easy to crack any GPAT, any NIPER exam or any competitive exam. Then how you can allot your week schedule for the subjects? For minor subjects like PP, physical chemistry, physical pharmacy, or microbiology, organic chemistry, 1 to 2 weeks are more than sufficient to cover these minor subjects. Now, how students miss this point? Most of the time, students try to invest much more time to the minor subject, and then they have very less time to study the major subjects. And that's why we focus that you have to complete minor subject within 1 to 2 weeks. And it is possible. For that, you have to know which topics are important. And for that, I'm going to share you the tricks and the how you should study or how you should focus on the major and important points. And for GPAT preparation and for NIPER preparation or for any other competitive exam, it's important that you know the important or the major concepts and you are thorough with those major concepts. So for that, 1 to 2 weeks of a minor subject is more than sufficient, and remaining 3 to 4 weeks, within 3 to 4 weeks, you are able to complete the major subjects like Coology, Cognosy, Medicinal Chemistry. And I'm going to tell you how this is possible. So this is the way you can complete minor subjects within 1 to 2 weeks and major subjects within 3 to 4 weeks. Learn by correlating various topics from different subjects. Most of the time students miss this point because students take one topic from one subject. For example, if we take I think there are many PharmD students also for them. If we take a subject from pathophysiology or ADR, adverse drug reaction, they can correlate with this, which is a clinical pharmacy point of view. Then a student will invest his time in ADR and he will have less time to study the remaining parts. So rather than doing and studying only a single topic or a single concept, you should have that aptitude and that attitude to correlate that single concept with the various concepts from the other allied subjects. Because our pharmacy, it might be PharmD or BPharm, both are the interdisciplinary subjects, interdisciplinary course. It is not like the engineering. In engineering, there are different fields for mechanical, for computers, but in pharmacy, in BPharm, in PharmD, we study each and every field, each and every discipline. Take Sutics, take analysis, take clinical pharmacy, take Coology. We study it together. And what's the purpose of that? So that because each and every discipline is intertwined with together. And that's why it's essential for us as a student to know that this concept is correlated with this concept of that another subject. For example, as the first line says that heterocyclic ring, name reaction and synthesis, which is a part of organic chemistry, which we study in first year, second year, it is the basis and it is correlated with the actual medicinal chemistry drug. For example, penicillin, for example, isoniazid. These drugs has a basis in the heterocyclic in the name reaction. The SAR or the synthesis, you will be able to understand this concept when you will be thorough with the name reaction, synthesis and heterocyclic rings. And that's why it's essential when you will start learning and revising or studying for your GPAT preparation, start correlating the concepts from various disciplines, various subjects. It will be very easy to understand the actual concept because in GPAT, questions will be applied. It won't be theoretical as that of our semesters. And applied questions, you have to know the actual concept. Moving to the next question, next example, diseases from HAP pathophysiology, which is the basis of the pharmacology. If you want to know the mechanism of action of, say, isoniazid, you have to know the pathophysiology of tuberculosis. You have to know the human anatomy. You have to know the lungs. Likewise, after knowing the mechanism of action of isoniazid, you have to know the drug of choice or adverse drug reaction, which is a part of clinical pharmacy. So like you can see, I was able to correlate different topics, different concepts from different subjects, and I was able to correlate those topics and cover various subjects in a go. And likewise, within 1 to 2 weeks, within 3 to 4 weeks, it's possible to complete the syllabus. Moving to another example from colloids, it is related to Sutex formulation. The colloids, which is from physical pharmacy, where we study surfactants, HLB scale, and those concepts. So for knowing the formulation aspect of emulsion, suspension, or NDDS, which is the actual formulation which we study in the Sutex, and which is a part of a Sutex syllabus, while studying those concepts, you have to know ki which surfactant you have to use to formulate a O by W emulsion or a W by emulsion, whether it will be a span surfactant or whether it will be a twin surfactant. So for that, you have to have that linkage, or you have to know ki, okay, colloids ka application is in emulsion suspension NDDS. So likewise, we have to study. Another and the last example, which is of biopharmaceutics, PharmD people can also correlate with this. For biopharmaceutics, which is the most important subject, I can say, from industrial perspective also, and in your masters also. So in that, and from GPAT perspective, questions are applied. Like they try to ask the calculation based question, like try to find out the volume of distribution, clearance rate, then what is the T half life, and or the question might be whether the injection formulation undergoes the first compartment model or second compartment model. Like this applied questions are there. So when it will be easy for us to solve those questions, when we have the knowledge of kinetics from physical chemistry. First year, I think so in first year, we have physical chemistry, kinetics chapter. Then first year or second year. Then the dosage form from CITIX, which is taught in third year. ADME, that is absorption, distribution, metabolism, elimination, which is a part of cology. So when you know all these three concepts, then only you will be able to solve the questions from biopharmaceutics, because it is the application of all these three subjects. And so likewise, whenever you will study, you should study by correlating various subjects and various topics. So this was the broad general idea ki how I studied, and I always suggest to students ki try to be applied. Don't just mug up the things. Then the next point, which is study similar topics together. It is correlated with the previous slide only. In here, I want to explain ki we have different same topic mentioned in, or similar topic mentioned in different subjects throughout our GPAT syllabus. For example, if you have your GPAT syllabus right now at your home, you can see colloids in PP, that is physical pharmacy, which is also a part of suspension emulsion, which is a part of a CITIX syllabus, and the mixing, which is a part of pharmaceutical engineering, and this suspension emulsion dispensing. So all these three topics has the same concepts. Same concepts we have to learn from the three different subjects. So is it better to know all the three topics together, and is it better to study all the three different subjects together? Yes, it is. So that you will be able to complete the vast syllabus in a go. So my suggestion will be, try to identify those topics which are similar in various subjects and study them, so that it will be easy for you to complete this vast syllabus. The another example, if you take your syllabus, you just find out ki carbohydrate and amino acid topic is mentioned in organic chemistry, in biochemistry, as well as in cognacy. We have three different, we can say they are not correlated with each other, but they have this two concepts, two topics given. So it's essential and it's helpful when you will study these carbohydrate, amino acids, similar topics from all the three different subjects, different disciplines, so that in a single go you are able to complete three different subjects, and it's really helpful at the end of your preparation, because at the end it's essential that you get as much as time to revise. Another example, cology and medicinal chemistry and clinical pharmacy. These three subjects goes hand into hand. It's not like how we study in colleges. In colleges, medicinal chemistry is taught by different faculty in different way. Cology is taught by different faculty, clinical pharmacy. But the core concept and the core ideology is that cology, medicinal chemistry, and clinical pharmacy should be meant to be studied together, because drug is present, that the same drug and the same molecule is present in all the three subjects. We have to know the mechanism of action of penicillin. We have to know the structural activity of penicillin, which is a part of medicinal chemistry. We have to know the DOC and ADR of penicillin, which is a part of clinical pharmacy. So it is wise to study different topics together. And I will always suggest that please study cology and medicinal chemistry together, because it's the ideal way to study these topics. Just the difference is that in coology, we have an additional point of mechanism of action, whereas in medicinal chemistry, we have an additional point of SAR, structural activity relationship. Rest of all the things are same, like ADME, in both we have to study. Then pharmacodynamics, pharmacokinetics, that is ADME. Then there is a classification, which is somewhat similar. Then moving to the next topic, like ADME from coology and basics of biopharmaceutics. So if you see your syllabus, that ADME part is mentioned in the pharmacology subject syllabus also, and in biopharmaceutics subject syllabus also. So it's ideal to know these topics which are given in various subjects and study those topics in a go. And this will help you to understand the actual concepts of these topics and actual application from various fields. So just taking another example and another perspective. So this is from my YouTube channel, Pharmascopy by Kaustubh Pawar, where I upload various YouTube GPAT online sessions. And its orientation is to understand the concept. So here, as you can see in this slide, this is the outline of the first session. And this tells us that how you can learn various concepts together. So the first concept which I explained was the local anesthetics, which is a part of pharmacology and medicinal chemistry. So we all know that local anesthetics has to be given by injections. It is a parenteral route of administration, and that injections come in a syllabus of pharmaceutics. So you have to have that ability to correlate that local anesthetics application, which is given through the injection parenteral route of administration, and study that injection part along with the local anesthetics, so that you can correlate the various topics and understand the core concepts. Now, again, local anesthetics is correlated with the biopharmaceutics. Local anesthetics mechanism of action is dependent upon its percent ionization, how much percent ionization occurs of a specific local anesthetic, say bupivacaine, lidocaine, and then only its mechanism of action or its efficacy level will be determined. So when local anesthetism of action ka core concept is based upon the percent ionization, which is a part of biopharmaceutics, it is wise to study that percent ionization concept, and then only you will be able to understand the mechanism of action. So here you are able to complete the biopharmaceutics subject ka ek topic. Then moving to another correlation, local anesthetics in medicinal chemistry, we have a classification. So we have two class, amide class and ester class. Amide class and ester class, how we can analyze it by pharmaceutical analysis technique. So we have a wonderful technique called as FTIR, IR spectroscopy. IR spectroscopy is helped to determine the functional groups based upon its percent transmittance. And as you can correlate, you know that local anesthetics are of two types, amide and ester, and that both can be analyzed by the FTIR technique. So it is wise and it is very helpful to understand the various ranges of carbonyl compounds of FTIR, because it is correlated with the local anesthetics. So here you are able to complete the pharmaceutical analysis topic also. Then DOC ADR, which is part of clinical pharmacy. So what are drug of choices of specific local anesthetics, say bupivacaine, or what is the ADR of lidocaine? Then the last point is of liposomes, as liposomes is a part of pharmaceutics, which is a novel formulation, upcoming in the field, or researchers or the scientists are trying to formulate the liposomes of the local anesthetics so that we get a prolonged action and it won't be needed to inject local anesthetics frequently. So this is the current, we can say, advancement in this field. So you have to have that aptitude, you have to have that broad vision. What are the current applications of the topics which you are learning? And likewise, you can understand the concepts. First of all, you can able to correlate various topics, understand its application. Third, you can complete various topics together and your syllabus will be completed. And fourth, ultimately, you will gain the knowledge and the skills which is required to get an All India ranker. Then another example from my GPAT online sessions, which I conduct every Sunday. On this Sunday, on today also, I had a session in morning. That's why we scheduled this meeting in the evening. So in that sessions, I usually educate and teach our students how to know how to understand the concepts and how to crack the GPAT. So from that only, I would like to give another example because examples help to understand. So as you can see, I have mentioned a sterilization techniques from microbiology. So rather than studying single sterilization technique at a time, it's essential that you study different sterilization techniques and correlate its advantages, its mechanisms, and its uses, so that you will be able to correlate and remember ki, okay, this is the use of this and this is the principle. And in a go, after seeing this table, you will be able to recall at the time of GPAT each and every property of a different sterilization technique. For example, we have two: thermal sterilization, non-thermal sterilization. So as you can see, in a single table, I am able to fit in the entire concept of sterilization techniques. And this is how you prepare your notes. In further slides, I'm going to share you how you should prepare your notes. So this is the one way you should prepare your note, by making tables and by enlisting different techniques together, so that you can understand and revise those techniques at a single time of point. Then moving to preparation technique, it's one of the essential point for your journey. So if you can see on the on the right hand side of your screen, I have mentioned how I prepared my technique, and on the left hand side, that is the pyramid of learning, which was the basis for my preparation technique. So we will first discuss how I prepared and how ideally anybody should prepare for GPAT or for cracking or for getting All India rank. First, you should start with a topic. You should learn that topic when you will start your learning process. Then after learning that topic, you should think logically on that topic, understand the concepts, and try not to mug up. That is the mistake where students miss out the point and they lose their position on the All India Rankers merit list. So it's not like our semester exam. That point you have to get it right, cleared in your mind. In semester, by mugging up, you can score, but in GPAT, you have to understand the concepts because questions will be applied. It won't be straightforward. So first you have to learn a topic, then you have to think it logically and understand the concepts. After understanding the concepts, how you can be sure that you have understood the correct concept? So I would use to discuss those concepts with my friends, and I would use to explain those concepts to my friends. So when you start explaining those concepts in your own words, you are sure that, okay, I have understood this concept and it will be fixed in your mind. So this act as a fixating agent. If we take an analogy from microbiology, in microbiology, we have a gram staining, acid fast staining. So in any gram staining technique or any staining technique, we require a mordant. Mordant is none other than fixating agent, which fixes the stain in the cell of my cell, in a bacterial cell. So in gram staining, we have potassium iodide and iodine as a mordant. So this explanation of concepts to your friends, act as a modern, act as a fixating agent of that concept in your brain and in your mind, and it retains throughout your lifetime. So practice those techniques, and at the end, solve those questions, because as we all know, practice is essential. Practice makes man perfect. Whenever you will finish your learning, finish your explanation of that concept, go and solve the previous year question papers. It will be we can say quality assurance test for your concept and your technique, whether you have understood that concept or not. So now we will correlate it with the pyramid of learning, which was the basis for my this path. So as you can see in this pyramid of learning, they have highlighted how much retention time, average retention rate or average retention percentage when you follow different types of techniques. So when you attend just mere lectures, when a teacher or when a faculty blah blah blah, and you just sit physically, mentally also, there is a retention rate of 5% only. When you personally read that concept or that topic, the retention time in retention rate increases by 5%, so it becomes 10%. So then when you saw that concept visually and audially, so when you see concepts or when you see their topic on YouTube or any lecture, the retention time increases till 20%. Then when you go, when you see any demonstration, so if there is a demonstration, there is a practical, so any person is demonstrating that technique, the retention time is 30%. Now, after that demonstration, when you will discuss, when you will participate in discussion group and when you will practice it by doing, the retention time rapidly increases, exponentially increases. It goes up to 50% and 75%. That is essential, because when you will practice it yourself, when you will solve those questions, when you will do practicals, you will be able to understand and retain those concept topics permanently. And at the end, the last maximum retention is observed when you will teach others, when you will explain those concepts to your friend. At that time, 90% of the concepts of the topics are retained with you. So always try to practice the participating teaching methods, like participating learning methods, we will say, like discussion in the groups, practice it, solving and teaching others or explaining those concepts other. So this is the basis. So this pyramid learning you can find out in on the Google also. It's a well studied, we can say, technique, and based upon that only I have designed my own preparation technique, which helped me to get that All India rank. Then moving to the next point, which is most important point from any students or any GPAT aspirant, that how we should make notes, because making notes is one of the critical aspect of this journey. While preparing notes, you have to understand that in GPAT, you require only important and bulletin points, not the notes like which we prepare for our semester exam. This has to be well clear in your mind. As you can see in this figure, I have a whiteboard where I used to practice and make my prepare my notes. So these are a few of the pics from those notes. So as you can see in the first figure, I have mentioned the heterocyclic synthesis or organic chemistry. So in organic chemistry, what is important? That first you have to identify and you have to make notes likewise. So in organic chemistry, name reactions, you have to know the reactant, you have to know the catalyst, and you have to know the end product. So that 3 points are important from GPAT perspective. So likewise, you have to prepare your notes. So I have enlisted different types of name reaction, Palnor, Fischer-Indahl, then pyridine synthesis. So likewise, you can prepare your own notes. So for that, prepare only bulletin points, only important points, and highlight those points so that whenever you will revise at the end in the revision span, like in November, December, it will be easy to recall that actual concept. In the second figure, you can see I have enlisted each and every formula from the biopharmaceutics. In biopharmaceutics, questions will be from GPAT. So for that, I have mentioned each and every topic from that biopharmaceutics, like the volume distribution, clearance rate, and the rest of the factors. Then moving to next point, which is topic, which is how to make notes for analysis. So this is an example of analysis. In analysis, we have to know the IR ranges and NMR ranges. That is one of the important points. So how you can remember those IR and NMR ranges? So by reading those NMR ranges or IR ranges, it's pretty difficult to understand and to remember those. So what you can do, you can make a visual graph of that. So likewise, I have prepared my own visual graph. I have just made a linear scale, linear graph, and I have plotted different IR values, functional groups, like from 3500 to 3000, which functional group has that IR value, from 3000 to 2200 range, which IR value, which functional group has that IR value, likewise. So by visualizing and by seeing this graph, you will be able to recall. And at the time of GPAT, when it is a split second, when you have to answer that question within 1 minute, this techniques helps you a lot. Another exam from pharmacognosy, which is a dry subject, which we all know that we have to remember the theoretical stuff from pharmacognosy. But for that, you can also prepare very smart notes. You can just enlist. Now, for this example, I have mentioned the stomata. So we have to remember which pharmacognostic drug has which type of stomata. So we have different types of stomata. So on a first column, you can mention the different types of stomata. And in front of that, you can mention the actual pharmacognostic drug. So likewise, you can make your own notes. So while making notes, don't waste much time in making notes, but make notes smartly and efficiently, and that will help you at the time of revision. So always remember these points. Then moving to the next point, the mnemonics and tricks, which is one of the key parameter that can help and that can come handy in GPAT. So mnemonics, this is a few of my posts from Instagram page where I publish or where I post my own notes. So for tetracycline, you can see there is a mnemonic called as Kapil Dev for the adverse drug reaction of tetracycline. So the mnemonic stands for like K stands for kidney failure, A stands for anabolic effect, P stands for photosensitivity, and likewise. So likewise, you can devise your own mnemonics, find out your own key points or tricks. Likewise, you can remember the core concepts or the theoretical concepts. Similarly, the diagnostic tests, which is a part of microbiology, and it is most important point we can say, because at least in couple of exams, in couple of years in GPAT, they try to ask at least one microbiological diagnostic test. So you can make your own table for diagnostic tests, like for syphilis, these are the diagnostic tests: VDR, Westermann, Khan, rabies, immunoassay, diphtheria, Sheik test, ALK test, leprosy, Leperman test. And likewise, if you are able to make these notes and tables in a tabular form, in a flow chart, or by applying many tricks, it will be handy at the time of GPAT preparation. So try to devise your own mnemonics or tricks. Then till now we studied, saw that why we should start your journey. You should decide ki why you want to start your journey. The next, how you can start your journey, how you can prepare throughout the journey. Now the last but not the least is the what to study. So that is the most easiest part, we can say, throughout this journey. First of all, part is that study smart. Hard work to sabhi karte hai. The key parameter is, though, the key differentiation point comes is who studies smart, who does the smart work in this 21st century. So this smart work in our case is that you should know what are the important bulletin points or bulletin concepts. What are the bulletin points or important concepts which have been asked frequently in the past GPAT exam? And there are chances that it will get repeated. So after analyzing previous 10-year question papers, I would able to find out that these are the few of the concepts which are frequently asked, which are most important from the GPAT perspective. So likewise, for NMR, IR ranges, usme se question to aayega hi. Classification, there will be one or two questions from pharmacological classification, from DOC, ADR. There will be one question from sterilization techniques, from biopharmaceutical calculations, from manufacturing equipment, from uses of pharmacognostical drugs. So these are the few or topics from which questions will be definitely asked. So likewise, you have that ability to identify which are the important and bulletin points, and that you should focus for preparing your GPAT. After that, the next point in studying smart is that you have to solve previous year question papers and why it is so important. First point, most of the time, the important topics get repeated. As I said, this is the few of the list which topics have been repeated in consecutive GPAT years. Another example, clinical trials in GPAT 2014, 16, 17, 18, 20, there has been question from this topic, from jurisprudence, from the schedules. There has been question from 14, 15, 16, 19, 20. As you can see, topics are fixed. And as we all know, in our semester exam, also in university exams, questions get repeated. That is the tendency of any examiner. Topics will get repeated. So you have to identify, and for that you have to solve at least 10 years of question papers, so that you will get an idea ki how questions are asked and what are the important points on which questions are being asked. So that's why it's very much important to solve previous year question papers, as well as practicing different questions from different sets of books. We have Inamdar, we have Pearson, Piyush, Muhammad Ali, various test series. Nowadays, various classes are doing, various online mock tests are there. Go and appear to those tests, because from my personal experience, I have solved around 2000 questions from each topic or each subject. So that after solving those many questions from various sort of books and test papers, you will get that confidence ki, okay, is topic mein se kaisa bhi question aaye, I am able to solve that question. So it's very important to practice and solve those previous year questions and allied other GPAT questions also. And the next point is sometimes questions get repeated. As I said, this is the clear best example from recent years, from the recent year, from this GPAT 2020 and GPAT 2019, that is previous year. You can see the same question has been asked twice consecutively, only the asking style has been changed. So first question says that the pyrogen present in containers can be destroyed by heating the container at. So they are asking depyrogenation temperature, which is 210 degrees Celsius, 3-4. This is the correct answer. Similar question has been asked in GPAT 2019. Containers may be rendered free from pyrogens by adequate cleaning by. The same options are there. And the correct answer is heating at 210 degrees Celsius for 3 to 4 hours. So as you can see, questions get repeated, and that's why it's essential to solve those previous year question papers. Then moving to the next point. So we know what we should study. Now we should know what are your stronghold. So for that, because in recent years, there have been the weightage for different subjects. For example, in GPAT, from pharmaceutics and allied subject, 20 to 25% questions have been allotted. Similarly, Cologic clinical pharmacy, 20 to 25%, 15 to 20% from medicinal chemistry and allied subjects, 10 to 15 for pharmaceutical analysis and 10 to 15 for pharmacognosy. So likewise, if you know your stronghold, like my stronghold was pharmaceutics, analysis, Cology, medicinal chemistry, cognosy, like, so likewise, if you know your stronghold, and then you will be able to solve, and you should focus on your stronghold first. And the second part, those are the weak subjects, you have to improve it slowly and slowly. So when you know your stronghold and you know, okay, pharmaceutics mein se 20 to 25% questions rahenge. So if you're sure that, okay, 20 to 25% questions may solve kiya, so definitely you will be able to qualify. Qualifying ko sirf 40 correct questions lagte hai. So it's pretty easy to qualify. So likewise, know your stronghold, know your strong subjects and improve on your weak subjects. Then for final year students, which will be going to appear for GPAT 2021, these are the few important topics which have been highlighted from various subjects after analyzing previous 10 year question papers, like from Cology, classification, mechanism of action, DOC, ADR, questions will be there. Medicinal chemistry, SAR, structure synthesis, sotics tablet, NDDS, aerosols. Then now what is ICH guidelines? They are asking which type of ICH guideline is Q1, Q2, likewise. Analysis, spectroscopy, IR, NMR, mass, that calculations will be there. Cognosy, uses CT, clinical, chemical constituent, chemical tests will be there. Then from minor subjects, PPPC, rheology, micromeritics, jurisprudence, schedules question will be there. Biopharmaceutics, compartment model, organic chemistry, name reaction, at least one question will be there. Heterocyclic rings, IUPAC names. Microbiology, microbial assay, sterilization, virus sterilization, vaccines, biotech. So these are the set of the topics which usually a GPAT examiner try to ask. It's not an entire list. It's just for your example. So, but likewise, you can focus on these topics. So based upon the last previous 10 year question papers, based on the statistics, this is the, we can say, most important topics from any competitive exam. So finally, as students, when you will revise these topics. Then moving to the next part, books which I preferred during my preparation. So these all are the reference standard books, like for physical pharmacy, physical chemistry, Martin is there. Then for pharmaceutics, Alton, Lackman, Remington is there. Then Indian Pharmacopoeia, US Pharmacopoeia, students miss this point. Most of the time students refer only standard books, but they should also refer the pharmacopoeias, because the core concept of that evaluation of tablets or for microbiological assay, the core concept is originated from the pharmacopoeia itself. So that's why go and refer the pharmacopoeias for studying those topics, like for tablet evaluation parameters and X, Y, Z. So focus on the original books like Indian Pharmacopoeia, Pharmacopoeia, Biopharmaceutics, Dispensing Pharmacy by Dr. Atmaramba, Biopharmaceutics by Ramankar, ICH guidelines, from pharmacology, KD Tripathi is there, Angan Dell is there, Sparsh Gupta is there. Sparsh Gupta is one of the, we can say, handy book for pharmacology, where Sparsh Gupta has, it is designed for competitive exams. So for pharmacology, do refer Sparsh Gupta. Vikas Seth is the book for pharmacology where classification is beautifully explained. So likewise, you have to study various topics from various books so that you you will be able to correlate the actual concepts. Then medicinal chemistry, Foyes is there, Wilson Griswold is there, Organic Berlenball, O.P. Tandon. O.P. Tandon is one of the good book from 12th NEET perspective, which I had. So that is one of the best book. Then for analysis, Cook for instrumentation, Pavia for spectroscopy, NMR, Cocarte for pharmacognosy. Then Pearson, Umang Shah, which is a good book for revision. But so you should know that. For revision, you can refer Pearson Umang Shah, but for studying, you should refer the reference books. Then Inamdar is there for studying or for solving the previous year question papers. So likewise, you can refer the reference books. Then moving to the next point. So this was the actual, we can say, the theoretical or the core journey. And this is the real life practical situation when we get into this journey, like what to do when you get stressed. And my philosophy is to relax, take a break, have a Kit Kat, because you cannot just burst each and every day and get busted at in the first week of your journey. Start slowly, sequentially, and whenever it gets tensed, it gets stressed out, take a break, relax yourself, and then again start your journey. Just don't stop your journey. That's the key important point. And the next philosophy is that enjoy the process. What happens, students miss out that this point, ki they just focus on the product, the end product, that is getting an All India rank or qualifying. But the biggest or the best journey is to enjoy the process. It's a process of 1.5 year, 1 year. So if you don't enjoy this process, it will get very tough for you guys to focus and to sustain throughout this journey. So I definitely enjoyed my process. And so when I'm delivering talks on this or sessions on this topic, I'm happy to share my experience because I enjoyed my process. So this is the key factor, you can say, practical situation which each and every students face through this journey. Even I have faced, I have gone into stress, and at that time I have relaxed and I have just restarted my journey. Then after that, this is the one of the helpful slide, I will say. I have just added this slide a few days back, that just studying through the reference books or solving question papers won't help. These are the actual practical things which help you ideally through your journey and cracking your GPAT exam. So these are the things, so these are the ways that help me to get my All India ranker. By participating in various paper presentation competitions, by participating in quiz competition, then initiating projects in BPharm which later failed, then participating in social awareness camps through this platform of IPSF, then explaining those concepts to your friends. These are the things which will definitely help you guys. So those who are in third year or second year, focus on this co-curricular activities, because when you will actually participate in such activities, you are applying your theoretical knowledge. So when you will participate in paper presentation, you have to actually think how to present, what will be the application of that, those concepts which are being studied in BPharm in first and second year. So these are the activities every BPharm graduate or every PharmD graduate should initiate and should get involved, because this will actually help it in your later life, like in when you will join your industry, these concepts will help. Then this was my journey, and my journey is not yet over. As in introduction said, I have initiated one platform called as Pharmascopy by Kaustubh Pawar. So there are three different streams, verticals in this. First is I started from Instagram, where I used to post my notes and how tricks, how you can prepare for your GPAT. Then initially I have started the YouTube channel, where I post, like every week I try to post videos from the GPAT perspective, how to prepare and the online actual prepare concepts. And I conduct online sessions every Sunday I've started this recently from August only, where I try, I personally conduct and educate the students for the GPAT preparation as well as pharmacy preparation. So this was the end of my session, my talk. I thank once again to the IPSF for inviting me. And this is the philosophy which I believe. Imagine the concepts. Once you start imagining the concepts, you will start understanding those concepts. Once you will start understanding those concepts, improve daily. You should improve daily. So imagine, understand, and improve. This is the tagline of Pharmascopy by Kaustubh Bauer. And once again, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. That was like really insightful. And I hope all the students who've been viewing it also found it the same. Now, anyone who has like any questions for sir, you can just raise your hands and then ask it away. Or you could just type it in the chat box. Okay. Yes, Anand.
Hello. Actually, my question is a very practical one since I'm from pharmacy background. I mean, everybody over here is a pharmacy background. And I, like many other people in pharmacy background, have never had good background of mathematics in our 12th and 11th and 12th. So there are many numerical questions that come into these exams which need calculus as a backbone of those questions, you know. Without calculus, without knowing the knowledge of taking derivatives or integration, we cannot solve those questions. So what would you tell us to improve our mathematics and to improve those skills of, calculus and everything like that?
Okay, thank you. Nice question. First of all, I would like to ask, do you have any question, actual practical question where calculus is involved? Because up to my knowledge, the questions which are involved in biopharmaceutics or in kinetics, we have to just apply the formula. Like for T half-life, if you want to calculate for any drug, we have the first order kinetics ka T half-life. So that actually, if though up to my knowledge, there is calculus is not directly involved, the derivatization. That is involved when you will study from semester point of view, if you want to write each and every question, derivatize that formula. But from practical perspective, direct questions are there. So if you have any practical problem, then we can discuss it. And if that is case, that if you are saying ki there is derivatives involved, then most important, you should know the concept of derivatization, because knowing superficially, you cannot solve. So for any perspective or any case, you have to know the actual concept in that. So that will be my point on this concept, this topic.
I guess that answers your question. Also, Deep Patel.
Hello.
Yes.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So basically, you have mentioned in the presentation that while preparing any of the sub one subject, so you have to correlate with other subjects. Okay. So while correlating with other subjects, so sometimes it leads to confusion, like कि पहले medicine करे या फिर ecology करे, तो start कैसे करना, मतलब correlation तो समझ गया, बहुत सही है, बहुत मस्त है, but उसको start कैसे करे कि पहले medicine पढ़ना है या फिर ecology को compare करना है, फिर दूसरे subject को compare करना है.
Start where which subjects which you like. If you like ecology, then start with ecology and then correlate with the medicinal chemistry. If you like medicinal chemistry, topics you can start from anywhere. If you take a topic from, say, example, agar aap third year mein hoge tuberculosis from then in tuberculosis we have medicinal chemistry structures of isoniazid. So at that time you can correlate its mechanism of action while studying, and at the same time you can study its SAR. So you can start anywhere. Just remember, just keep in mind that it's better to correlate. You can start from the application perspective. Another example for this question, if it is a vast subject like from principle, if you take a SUTEX point of view, its basis is in PP, physical pharmacy colloids. Its application is in tablets, is in emulsion suspensions. So you can start with the suspension emulsion topic also and then study the basis, or you can start with the basic concepts and study its application. You can start anywhere, just start and correlate.
Yes, Anant wants
any other?
Hello, I'm extremely sorry. I got disconnected in between.
Yeah, it's okay.
You said that it's not in GPAT. I wasn't actually talking about GPAT. I'm trying to give GATE. And in GATE biotechnology, in process biotech, and in also in fed batch culture and all the growth yield wala concepts which are there now.
Yes.
So if you want to find out a yield coefficient, they will ask you to derive a formula of yield coefficient.
Correct. In such type of questions, sorry to interrupt. Yeah, I got your point. Okay, if it is an biotechnology perspective for if you are giving JNU, which is for biotechnology pharmaceutical, or for GET biotechnology, at that in those questions in those exams, there will be applied questions and you have to derive. So for that, it's ideal to know the derivatization concept. So if our maths is weak, then we have to focus on those subjects. Then only we will be able to solve. Essay directly we can't solve, na? So concepts actually we have to know. So my point will be you should study the derivatization techniques, understand, take help of your friends, colleagues, and then it will be helpful to attempt those questions.
Any specific resource would you suggest or any specific technique for studying maths?
For studying maths, I will say you should practice. It's same as that of organic chemistry. If you'll solve or if you'll practice as much as possible those same questions, you will get and you will understand those steps. That is my take on maths.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, Anand. Narayani?
So I wanted to ask, like, third year is the main pharmaceutical subjects are being introduced in our curriculum, and like most of our time goes in a college, like from 10 to 5 we are there in the college and the assignments and we are packed up, and you said at least 2 to 3 hours daily self studies are necessary. Yeah. So how can we manage everything, the college studies side by side, and also preparing for our entrance exams?
So college study, as you said, college is from 10 to 5. So it is, I think, so 7 hours, correct? So
yes,
we
sir.
Have 24 hours in our hand. So just we will calculate the actual stuff. 24 hours, 7 hours went to. So your day, like my day, I will give my example. My day, while I was preparing for GPAT, my day started at 5 a.m. So I know everybody has from 10 to 5 or from 9 to 6 college. My college was from 9 to 5, not from 10 to 5. So I had one more extra. So I must start usually from 5 or 6 a.m. So you get initial 1 to 2 hours in morning, 5 to 6, 5 to 7. If you have a 10 a.m. college, if you require 1 hour of travel, that goes. So 5 to 6 or 5 to 7 or 6 to 8 a.m. 2 hours you got. Then you study, for your colleges, prepare for your preparation. During your college tenure only, like from 10 to 5, try to understand those concepts there itself. So it will save your time. I know it's very difficult to learn in college. We all know what are the factors. So that's why self-study is important. Then after coming home at 5, then we have... You can spare 2-6 for traveling till home. Then you can start your preparation at 7. So 7 to 8 or 7 to 9. 7 to 8 you can go. You can spare for your GPAT preparation or any competitive one. For 8 to 9, 1 hour, it's more than sufficient from semester perspective. Because we all know ki semester ka jab exam ka date aata hai, then only we start preparing for semesters. So it's a well-known fact across the students. So you can study 1 hour, even if you are studying daily for your semester exams, you can spare 1 hour. So ideally you got in morning 2 hours, in evening 2 hours. And if you cut off your extracurricular time pass activities, if you all watching TV, watching movies and spending a time at Chaikatta, then you will get 1 more hour also. So if you get actually 5 hours, and at the end, you can sleep at 10, 11. You will have your 8 hours sleep. If you sleep at 10 a.m. or 11 a.m. and you can wake up at 6 a.m. So likewise, you can devise your own time schedule. But at least for 1 year, you can invest, I can say 2 to 3 hours if you really want to get that all India rank, we can say. So it's not that.
I had a,
yeah,
you actually gave a very appropriate answer for that. I actually had one more question, that because we are in our homes and we are quarantined and we are having a lot of screen time as well. So some ways to relax so that, you know, we give a rest to our eyes, to our laptops as well. So how can we refresh and get back to our routine again?
You can relax. You can take a nap. I personally like to take a nap of 10 to 15 minutes in between of the day, because I am a, like I can say, a Punekar. So Punekar sleeps from 2 to 4, 1 to 4. So I used to get a sleep. So as you are lucky that you are in a home and you can have your nap period. And whenever in between those sessions, I think so you have sessions in morning and then in afternoon. And in between you have 1 to 2 hours. So you can take your nap. That is one of the great technique. Or else you can engross yourself in various hobbies. If you like reading or if you like anything, singing, you can take participate in it. It's a practical perspective, okay, how you relax yourself. My way of relaxing is to take a nap, a beautiful sleep, and then start with my daily routine.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
That's actually really nice what you said, that we have to invest in ourselves at least for, you know, that particular time in which we need.
Correct.
That. Because if we need something, we need to invest in it as well. That's true.
So the another word is to sacrifice. So rather than sacrificing, I will say invest.
Yeah. Deep, you want to ask something?
Yes, sir. Hello.
Yes, yes.
In while preparing pharmacognosy, so in pharmacognosy, there are so many drugs. Means in like, if we take like in alkaloids, there are many of the drug examples in resin. So when we are doing a rapid fire question, means if rapid fire question does my friend does, so he asked that ki bro chal tu alkaloid ka bhi me koi example de. So उसका बायोलॉजिकल क्लासिफिकेशन बायोलॉजिकल नेम क्लास फैमिली मींस फॉर दैट हाउ वी विल डू द प्रिपरेशन मींस हाउ इट ऑब्वियसली वी हैव टू मींस मग अप दैट मींस सम डिफिकल्टीज वाज लाइक फैमिली सो इट्स टू मच डिफिकल्ट टू लर्न एट वन गो फॉर द अल्कोलॉइड फॉर द रेजिन्स एंड फॉर द टैनिन्स एंड ऑल सो इज देयर एनी ट्रिक्स और ट्रिप्स दैट हाउ कैन वी रिमेंबर दैट
या सो फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल फॉर एनी ड्राई सब्जेक्ट we will classify as a dry subject because it is a mugging subject, we all know. And in GPAD perspective also, there are theoretical questions from pharmacognosy where we have to actually remember. So for remembering, you cannot remember everything in a go. So like for these subjects, like for pharmacognosy, you can study a specific a set of colloids. We will take a real life example, set of a colloid drugs at a time. So if you are studying on Monday, you can study 5 pharmacognostic drug on Monday. You can revise for a couple of days. Then on Thursday, you can take few other pharmacognostic drugs. So likewise, if you split those theoretical subjects and if you just invest 15 to 20 hours or 15 to 20 minutes, sorry, for those theoretical subjects and revise it daily, it will help you a lot. Because if you will, like as you said, if you will start studying everything of pharmacognosy at a point of time, it is very, very difficult and it is like nearly impossible to do it. So just invest your 15 to 20 minutes for these dry subjects, study those theoretical points, revise for a couple of times, and most important, discuss with your friends. Because if your friend is studying, say, imidazole alkaloids, and if you are studying pyridine alkaloids, purine alkaloids, and if you share your knowledge, you will be able to understand better than when a teacher explains it. Because when our friends explains those same concept to us, na, it's easy to understand. So these are two techniques which you can follow for these theoretical subjects.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. It will really help. Yes.
Welcome. Thank you, Deep. Anyone else who has any questions? Okay, so I guess I don't have the questions. Thank you so much, sir. That was really helpful. You answered all the questions everyone had. And I really love the part how you began with the thing that the journey is very important, because it actually is. The most important part of the entire thing is the journey. It's not what you achieve. It's not, you know, when you want to start. It's the journey, it's the process that we all love. And the professor shared everything from the why to the how to the what, everything that you'll need. And he also shared everything related to the topics as well, how we can, you know, coordinate between the topics. Okay, we have one more question before we end this. That's why ICT, not NIPER for MPharm?
So I personally preferred ICT. Like, it's your preference up to the student. So before choosing the university from where you want to do your master's, in India, we have NIPER and we have ICT. These two are the most prominent, most influential universities. So for NIPER, you have to know how the structure is built. When I was researching for the university, ICT, its curricula was designed likewise. Say for 1 year, you had your theoretical subjects, and for 6 months, you had internship. And then for remaining, you had your practical, your MPharm project. So that internship, actually, I like that internship part in the in ICT curricula for MPharm, because if you get a hands-on experience in industry where ultimately you want to work or you have to work, so you get that hands-on experience in during your master course itself, it will definitely help. So that was the one factor which pulled me towards the ICT than the NIPER. NIPER has a 1 year of curricula, a theoretical, and 1 year of practical. But from this year, because of COVID, ICT has dropped that internship program, and they have same curricula as that of NIPER. So rest all is same as that of NIPER and ICT. Both are the equivalent, we can say, and both are the best colleges in the India.
Great. So I guess Shivani's question was answered. From my side, you know, apart from all this, I have just one question. All of us are over here are IPSF members, and you yourself have served as a member for a very long time. So what's that one or two things that, you know, the major takeaways from whatever you learned during this journey? Because all of us are members, we all would love to know what we can take away from
that. So first of all, the leadership or the ability to speak in front of the crowd. As you can see, before third year, before participating in IPSF, I was on the other side of the desk, I can say, on the other side of the podium, was the listener. But after participating in IPSF, I got that confidence and I came across that barrier of that podium, and I'm standing on this side and delivering the session. So that confidence building is one of the key factors which you can learn. And the second part is how you can collaborate with various students, how you can work as a team. Because in IPSF, if you want to do any activity, the most important point is teamwork, and IPSF teaches us how actually you should be a team member, and solo you cannot achieve any goal in your life. So you can be a leader as well as you can be a team worker through IPSF.
So I guess all of you understood what we'll get from IPSF. I guess everyone is very psyched, and we really loved, you know, everything that you had prepared for us today, and it was really insightful. I would like to take this opportunity to thank you on behalf of the entire IPSF team and the core members. Do you have any parting message for the students who are preparing for GPAT?
So for GPAT, focus on the journey, enjoy the journey. Rest of all will happen itself.
Thank you so much. So we'll end here. Just a request from all the attendees, if you could just switch on your cameras for a second and, you know, smile, where our editor could take a picture. Cool enough. We'll just take a picture right now. Okay. Thank you everyone for being here today and learning from the best. And thank you so much, first up, sir, once again for, you know, answering all our questions and making it very clear as to how to prepare for these examinations that we are about to face. space in the near future. Thank you so much.
IPSF is most welcome anytime.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.